Good morning, everyone. So in the last few SEGs, you might have seen sessions upon sessions dedicated to the topic of full waveform inversion. And that's because a lot of people in the industry and academia are working on various aspects of FWI. In the case of multi-parameter FWI, a lot of research is oriented towards, for instance, acoustic approximation of VTI models, where they're trying to invert for three model parameters. So in our case, we are looking at elastic, we are looking at inverting for an elastic VTI model. So in this case, I'm going to show you the work that we've been doing on a synthetic model based on the Wall-Hall field. So we use multi-component data, so it's and we model energy that's polarized in 2D plane. So it's, which means we've got four model parameters that can sufficiently describe energy polarized in a 2D plane. So we invert for Thomson parameters, and we have the potential, since we use the Elastic Modeling Code, to model the reflection coefficients, which might provide us some information when we do the inversion. So the objective function is the quite familiar L2 norm of the difference between the observed data D and model data U. The summation over shots and receivers is implied in this case. Last year I showed you in some details about how we get from the objective function to the gradient of the objective function by setting up the Lagrangian and doing some algebra. And John showed us a couple of days ago how to do that even in a lot of steps and with a lot of clarity. So I'm not going to go over those steps again. I'll just present the gradient expression, which is the zero Lacrosse correlation of the source and of spatial derivatives of the source and adjoint wave fields. Once we have the gradient with respect to the stiffness coefficients, we can obtain the gradients with respect to the model parameters of our choice. Now, there's been a lot of debate, like we had yesterday, about what the appropriate model parameterization is. There are different combinations that one can use, and we use a specific combination, which is the vertical P and S wave velocities and the P wave horizontal and NMO velocities. So one reason we use this is because all of them have the same order of magnitude and the same units. And the other reason is that velocities, as opposed to stiffness coefficients themselves, constrain travel times and amplitudes. I'll show you one other parameterization that we are working on, but for now I'm going to just stick to these four model parameters. So this is the synthetic model that we use for our tests. It's based on, it's called the Wall-Hall model, so it's based on the geology of the actual Wall-Hall field. So the actual model was created just for the P-wave velocity. However, the SciScope group has developed epsilon, delta, and VS0 fields, and they were kind enough to provide the models to us. So the yellow dots on the top represent sources, and the receivers are also placed at the same depth at every grid point. The horizontal blue lines you see in the model are low velocity layers, which indicate gas clouds. And the reservoir is at a depth of 2.5 kilometers. In the original model that was provided to us, there is a water column 71 meters deep at the top. But in our case, we got rid of the water column, so the entire model is elastic. So to generate the observed data, we use a vertical displacement source whose time function is a recurve wavelet with a peak frequency of 5 hertz. We've got 109 sources with a source interval of 80 meters. As I said, the receivers are placed on every grid point. We use a multi-scale approach in which we go from different frequency ranges shown on the slide here, and we use we scale the gradient by an inverse hessian that's computed using the low memory equivalent of the bounded BFGS hessian. So that's the actual model that we use to generate the observed data. So as I said, we got rid of the water column, so it's the shear wave velocity doesn't go to zero anywhere in the model. At the top, where it was zero, we set the shear wave velocity such that the VS zero, such that the VP-VS ratio is 2. Epsilon and delta are relatively simple structurally. The maximum value of epsilon goes to 0.15, and that of delta goes to 0.06, which would probably be considered moderate anisotropy. Now, this is the initial model we used. So from here on, I'm going to show you only the model in terms of the model parameters, which are velocities. I'm not going to show you epsilon and delta anymore. So you might notice that we haven't really done a very heavy smoothing. So it's the initial model is not very far from the actual model. And one of the reasons is because we want to see what happens. Like in the best case scenario, since we are doing a multi-parameter inversion, are we really able to get some more information out of the reflection coefficient information present in the data? So assuming that you have the best case possible, we want to see what how our inversion proceeds in this case. So these are the updates we get for the first frequency band. The updates here and in the rest of the frequency bands are always computed with respect to the final model for that frequency band minus the initial model, starting model that I showed in the previous slide. So you might notice that the updates are not only small, but compared to the actual, the desired update, which is shown here, but also the frequency content, of course, is also very small. So we don't have very good resolution. You might notice that we have a lot of updates in the shallow layers. And now we'll take a look at a profile, the velocities at a certain location in the model, shown by the vertical black line. So the black lines indicate, the black plots indicate the actual velocity model. The magenta indicates the initial velocity model, which is sort of hidden by the updated model, which are represented by the green lines. And that's because based on the previous slide, there's not a huge update in the model for this frequency range. So we go into the next frequency range, but before that, I'll show you the data misfit. So that's the initial data misfit, and that's the final data misfit. Initial, final. So like I mentioned before, I think most of the update happens at in the shallow layers for this frequency range. There is a little bit of update that takes place based on the reflected events, but most of it is for at the shallow layers. Right now, next we go on to 0 to 3 hertz. Now, in this case, you might notice straight away that there's a much bigger update in the velocity models, and there's also a high resolution, which we get by incorporating higher frequencies into the inversion. So compared to the previous frequency band, again, there's a much bigger update. And it's getting closer to the desired updates. So I'd like you to notice a few things here. First, there doesn't seem to be a significant update in the case of VS0, which is a bit disappointing because I was hoping that we would be able to get some updates since we are doing elastic modeling. So we're still working on that. So apart from that, you might see the magnitude of the updates are largest for VP0 and V horizontal, and somewhere slightly less for VNMO. And Another point to notice is that the updates in the case of VP0 happen for shallow and deeper parts of the model, and also for a much larger lateral extent. In the case of V-horizontal, the updates are large, as I said, but there are also a lot of updates take place in the shallow layers, and the lateral extent of the updates decrease as we go deeper down. And we notice something similar for the case of VNMO. And please keep this in mind, because I'm going to get back to these towards the end of the presentation. So now you got the profiles once again, and here you see that VP0 now looks much better than in the previous case. So we've been able to increase the values, and it also follows the higher wave numbers quite closely for most cases. In the case of V-horizontal, we don't have the trend is, it fits the trend quite well, but of course it doesn't fit the high wave number component accurately enough. In the case of V-horizontal, there is some improvement, but it's still not as significant as in the case of VP0 and V-horizontal. And in the case of VS0, of course, we're still, I've got a couple of pointers from talking to people here about how to proceed and try to update VS0 more appropriately. So that's the data misfit we have for the initial model in this frequency band. And that's the final data misfit. So now you see that there's a much bigger difference in the shallow layers as well as for the reflected events. And now we go on to the next frequency band, which is 0 to 5 hertz. And in this case, I've plotted this on the same scale as the previous frequency band, because the magnitude of updates is not very large. So if I flip back and forth, so that's the current as the previous, you'll see there are some differences in the shallow and deeper regions. And these will be more apparent in the when I show you the profiles. So there you go. So you might notice, again, if I flip back and forth between this and the previous frequency band, current, previous. So let's look at VP0 for now. So what happens is, you see there's, the VP0 seems to decrease in this case. So it's done actually a worse job for this frequency band. Both VP0, so current, previous, current, previous. And if you look at V-horizontal, it's the same story. Seems to have decreased slightly. This is the current, previous. And on the other hand, VNMO seems to have improved. So that's the current frequency band, that's previous, current, previous. So this sort of indicates the trade-off that exists between VNMO and VP0 and VNMO and V-horizontal. So a slight worsening in VP0 and V-horizontal is the cost, in this case, we pay for an improved VNMO. And these trade-offs can be represented in terms of what are known as radiation patterns, which I've spoken about last year. I'm going to very briefly go over it and try to tie this, tie the results we see here to the radiation patterns. So what are radiation patterns? Suppose we have an anomaly in one of the model parameters at a point x dash in the subsurface. So when energy from xs is incident on the scatterer, the anomaly, then the energy that's scattered by the anomaly is dependent on the angle of scatter. So when we plot that, these patterns, we get some more idea about which model parameter can be updated. So I'm going to show you the radiation patterns for the P wave feed for an anomaly situated on a horizontal reflector. So in this case, we see that for an anomaly in VP0, most of the energy scattered is for close to vertical incidence angles. So what happens is, when you have energy incident close to the symmetry axis, then a lot of the energy is reflected back, scattered back, which means that we're going to see a big update in the model for small incidence angles, which again means that we'll be able to look deeper into the model. And also, because the scattering angle is small, we should be able to see updates for larger lateral extent in the model. In the case of V horizontal, we see that the amplitude of scatter is very large for very large incidence angles, which means that for shallow layers, we should be able to see updates for a much larger lateral extent. But when we go deeper down, because the angle, the incidence angle keeps decreasing, we'd see smaller updates. So the large updates would be restricted to a smaller lateral extent in the model as we go deeper down. In the case of VNMO, the maximum amplitude of scatter is quite small compared to VP0 and V horizontal. So we're going to see less updates, smaller updates, and something similar to V horizontal, meaning larger updates, as in we'll see updates for shallow layers in all range at all distances, and as we go deeper down, the lateral extent is going to keep decreasing. The one strange thing is, of course, the radiation pattern for VS0, which seems to indicate that we should be able to update VS0 quite well, but so far we haven't been able to do that. And one of the reasons might be that the source we use is a vertical displacement source. Maybe if we use a horizontal displacement source, we'll be able to excite more intensive shear wave energy, and that might help us update VS0 better. So based on these observations, I once again put up the slide from the 0 to 3 Hz frequency range, where we have seen that the updates for VP0 and V horizontal were very large. The magnitudes were large. In the case of VP0, we had updates that that happened at shallow and deeper regions for the model, and we saw updates for a much larger lateral extent. But in the case of V horizontal, the lateral extent kept decreasing as we went deeper down, and something similar for VNMO, except that even the amplitudes of the updates in the case of VNMO were smaller. So that's the other parameterization that we're working on. It's log of the vertical velocities squared and scaled epsilon and delta. This is based on the parameterization that was introduced by Shen in 2012 in his FEG abstract. The reason this seems interesting is because first we see a much faster decrease in the objective function. It's much steeper, and we see much larger updates as a result, especially in VP0. And that also can be explained in terms of radiation patterns, but this is one parameterization we would like to try. And if you have time, I'm sure we'll try some other parameterizations as well. So in this study, we perform elastic FWI for a synthetic VTI model. So I think I hope I've been able to demonstrate with the help of radiation patterns why we see the results that we do see. Of course, in the case of VS0, it's still a problem. The best updates in this case occur for VP0 and V horizontal. So we're still investigating the VS0 updates. Once we have a horizontal displacement force, we might be able to do a better job of updating the VS0 parameter. And we're looking into inverting for other parameterizations. Of course, from Tariq's talk, I think one thing would be to apply a wave number filter and see if you get better updates, more meaningful updates in the model. So I'd like to acknowledge the members of the A team and I team, especially Yuting, who modified the elastic modeling code that we use in this case. I'd like to thank Romain Brossier for providing us the model for the study. Both Romain and Olaf Buckwit. And I had lots of discussions with Chinle and Fong in BP Houston while I was there interning. And I'd like to thank them for the discussions we had. Thank you very much.